So we're going to need one more interesting property of this operator B1, but this one is specific to the context of policy iteration. So let's think about it this way. Imagine we've got some policy Pi1, just like we've been saying, and associated with Pi1 is the operator B1, and let's say that Q1 is the fixed point of B1, right? And how do we know that it has a unique fixed point?
Because you proved it earlier.
Yeah, and it was the contraction property of B1.
Yeah.
So let's imagine that's happened. We've solved out Q1. And this is sort of how policy iteration works too, right? You start off with a policy, you get the value function of that policy. Then we're going to take the greedy policy, Pi2, with respect to Q1. So in the last slide or so, Pi1 and Pi2 were just arbitrary policies. Now Pi2 is specifically the greedy policy with respect to the value function defined by Pi1. So then let B2 be the operator associated with Pi2. And this is the thing that we want to show. The Q function that comes from solving for the fixed point of Pi1, so the value function for Pi1, is less than or equal to B2 applied to Q1. So does that make sense? So if we take whatever we end up with after we solve for the value function for Pi1, we take Pi2's greedy policy, and then we do one Bellman backup with respect to that, and we get a value function that dominates Q1.
Okay, and that's because of other stuff on the slide.
Yeah, so we'll just work through that. So intuitively, what we're saying is you do policy evaluation on Pi1, we get some value function Q1, and then we do one step of essentially value iteration using the greedy policy with respect to Q1, and that's going to make it no worse, possibly better. And so the reason for that is, well, what is Q1? Q1, it's the fixed point of the B1 operator. So in this particular case, it's the reward plus the discounted expected value for taking action Pi1 and then ending up in some new state S prime and taking action Pi1 of S prime from that state.
Mm-hmm.
But think about what Pi2 is. We can actually substitute Pi2 for Pi1 in here, but Pi2 is the greedy policy with respect to this. In other words, it is the policy that causes this exact quantity to be maximized. That's what the greedy policy does. At every state, either we're going to do no worse than we did with Pi1, or we might actually do better by switching to Pi2, the greedy policy with respect to Q1. So at each state action pair, we're doing no worse by doing one step of, well, one Bellman backup with B2 on Q1. So this is exactly the result that we get, that the Q function that we had before is less than or equal to the Q function that we had before pushed through the B2 operator, right? The Bellman operator with respect to the greedy policy with respect to Q1. You know, essentially the idea is if we're going to do one more update on Q1 and we're going to do that update with respect to a policy that we know is greedy with respect to Q1, then we're moving up in the world.
Oh, I see. Okay.
What?
Well, no, I was sitting there thinking, well, shouldn't this be greater than or equal to? And then I think, oh, no, I see. I was reading it backwards.
Yeah, I wanted to write it as, because domination up to this point we used greater than or equal to, but it just didn't feel right to put it this way, because it would have been B2 applied to Q1 is greater than or equal to Q1, which is true, but the ordering feels backwards to me. So this seems better, that we're going to take Q1, we're going to apply the B2 operator to it, and it's going to make things better.
Write it the other way and see what happens.
Sure.
So when I look at that, that says that applying the greedy operator to Q1 makes it better than it was before.
All right. So if that is more helpful for you to read, it's really the same thing. So that's great.
Oh, no, it is the same thing. I just realized the whole time you were talking, I had been flipping the thing in my head.
Sorry about that.
Oh, no, it's not your fault.
So now we have all the pieces we need. We had one property, we called it monotonicity. What we should call this property something too. Value improvement.
Okay.
So now with value improvement and other stuff like the definition of Pi2 and B1 and B2 and Q1 and Q2 and the monotonicity property, we should have all the things we need to prove that policy iteration moves in the right direction, that it actually improves the policy. Or in the case where the policy is already optimal, it can't improve it, but it doesn't break it, leaves it the same.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't ever make it worse.